Hi, welcome to How to Repair. Today we're working on a tumble dryer manufactured by a Chinese company called Midea. Now for the UK market, it's manufactured for Currys under Logik and Argus under Bush. And all these other brands that you can see on the screen here, Midea actually produce these machines for. It's not a bad machine. We'll be going through how to replace every component on the machine, and I'll timestamp it below to try and break up the video for you. The accessibility to some of the components on this machine is ludicrous. That's the only word I can actually say. It made me throw my tools around today. So let's get on with it, and I'll show you firstly how to test the heating system. Okay, first things first, this is a new appliance, so therefore you're going to see the exact readings that you should be getting. Now, if your tumble dryer is not getting hot and it's going through the cycle but it's just not getting warm, you need to ascertain whether you actually are drawing the correct power for the heating circuit to be coming on. Now, I'm lucky that I've got these amperage meters, and I've also done a video, which is the link in the description, to a portable device that you can buy for less than a tenner, which will actually show you the power that the machine is drawing. This machine is drawing 2200 watts. That is the element combined with the motor that's actually running. Now, to gain access to the actual heating element and the thermostats, the first thing we need to do is disconnect the machine from the power supply, and then we need to turn the machine round and take the lid off, and then we'll be taking the back of the machine off. To remove the lid is straightforward, two screws, then give the lid a tap backwards and remove. Okay, now we've got the lid off the machine, let me explain the heating circuit to you. You've got a single circuit heating element, which is a large circular element that goes around the heating plate at the back. You've got a cutout thermostat, but this one is resettable. There is a button at the back of the machine to reset it if the machine ever overheats, so always test that first. You have the cycling thermostat here, and this actually cycles, I believe, somewhere in the region of 80-90 degrees, and that will cut in and cut out to control the temperature of the actual heating going into the dryer. And you also have an Ntc sensor at the bottom of the machine, which we'll get to later. To test the element, just take off the two connectors, turn your meter on. I've set it to 200 range on ohms, and if you do a reading across the element, we have approximately 28 ohms resistance. That means that you have approximately an 1800 watt element, and that is in good condition. Of course it would be. Then you have the two thermostats, and you only need to set the meter to continuity on these. Take the two terminals off each, and then just do a reading across both of these, and you've got continuity. Going across the back one, you've got continuity. Now, to actually take out the heating element, the whole back of the machine needs to come off. We've got to take the back off anyway to actually gain access to the Ntc sensor, which is at the bottom. Okay, the manufacturer is quite thoughtful with these machines. On the back of your machine, there is usually a wiring diagram as well, showing you the actual electrical circuit. I will take a copy of this and put it in the description for you. Now, you don't need to remove all the screws. There's a couple at the top. You only need to remove the ones that are going through the back panel. You can actually take the back panel off without taking the vent connection off, but to take the vent connection off, just lift it and twist, and it will come away. Then the back panel can come away, but make sure the wiring for the thermostats is disconnected, otherwise you will have a problem getting enough space to actually turn the plate around. This then gives you access to the heating system, and at the bottom here we have the Ntc sensor. Okay, the Ntc sensor is quite an awkward one to get at, and I'm not going to actually take it out on this machine because it is a new machine. But basically, the front of the machine has to come off to gain access to this Ntc sensor. It is possible, if you've got the right tools, like a hook like this, to actually get this Ntc sensor out, because it's got a mounting plate at the back, but I don't want to damage anything and try and do it just for this video. But let me just show you the ohms reading that we have on this machine and how to test it. The two yellow wires on the Logik machine connects to the Ntc sensor. You just need to undo it. Now, the multimeter will not go in with the probes to get a good contact. So a little hack for you: either use a paper clip and cut it in half, or use a couple of these electrical connectors that you can see here, and then just put one in on either side. Then you're able to put your multimeter probes into that. And I've got this set up on a 20k range at the moment, and we've got an ohms reading of approximately 1630 ohms reading. And of course, as the temperature changes, the ohms reading will change, and this is what tells the circuit board what temperature the actual airflow going through the ducting system is. And then this then controls the relay on the circuit board, which then sends power to the heating element. Now, to remove the heater or gain access to the bearings on this machine is one of the most ludicrous designs I've ever come across. Firstly, it's a two-man job. You're going to need a very large Allen key to go inside the drum and a 14mm spanner to undo this nut, because when you try and turn it, the nut turns with the bolt, but there is no way of actually stopping the bolt turning unless you've got a second person to hold the actual pin inside. And let me show you inside the machine. Now, inside here is a cover which originally I was thinking had to come off, because the Allen key locking place for it is very, very small. You've actually got to have an Allen key which sits flush in there, because it's only a couple of mil, but you've got your hand here and you can't get round to the back. So it's actually a two-man job to actually do this. Someone actually has to hold this in place while accessing the back. It would be good if they actually put a slot in the shaft, which I'll show you now. Okay, as I was saying, this is one of the most ludicrous designs that I've ever come across. Somehow they should have put a slot in this actual shaft bolt, because when you try and undo this, the actual shaft itself is turning with the nut. Now, I've managed to get this off, but if they either had a cover on the inside that would come away, or an actual slit in this shaft to undo the bolt. The only suggestion I've got for you is put the spanner onto the nut and actually give it a tap with a hammer. Just by doing it quick, the impact of this might release it, so you can actually get this nut off the shaft on your own. Otherwise, it's a two-man job. You will need the Allen key with a very flush fit to fit on the inside of the drum to actually hold this bearing shaft in place. So once you've got that off, you can then remove the four screws on this side, and you will need to loosen one panel to actually get the drum out of the lip here. Okay, before you undo these screws, I do suggest you actually release the tension off the belt. The reason for this is once you try to start moving this drum, it's such a awkward type of machine to work on that the drum will pull down and you'll end up with so many frustrating problems. Let me explain the way the belt works. The belt goes over the actual motor shaft, around the pulley, and then around the drum. You've got a spring on this side that you can only gain access to if you take the whole side paneling system off, which again is an absolute nightmare. Another thing to notice, if you ever have a tumble dryer that is not turning correctly due to a capacitor failure, the capacitor on this, you still have to go with the side panel off to gain access to the nut to remove the actual panel. This machine is actually making me want to give up repairing appliances. It is that mad. So anyway, to remove the belt, just pull on the pulley wheel or tilt the motor down, take the belt off the pulley wheel, and then put it back, and that releases the tension completely. Now you're able to undo these bolts and remove the actual panel. Once they're out, you have got a little bit of movement here, but not really. Ooh, yeah, we can just do it. Lifting it off one side, lift it up on the other side, and then you'll have to prise the panel slightly, and that gives you access to the heater. Then it's straightforward to replace. You'll just need to undo the screws around here to replace the heating element. But while I've got this off, I'm going to show you this ludicrous bearing assembly. You've got a little bush here which sits on top, The screws for the actual bearing cover are underneath here, and you've got one retention lug that you need to press down to take that cover off on the inside. And let me show you how to do that. Just press down this pin and then rotate this, and then the cover will come away. I'm actually going to lift the drum out of this machine now just to show you the bearing assembly for anyone that wants to change the bearing in the future. Okay, the belt is straightforward. That just comes around. So if you're needing to replace the belt, you could actually replace the belt without taking the heating unit off by sliding it over. But I might make another video on that if this machine doesn't drive me insane. Now, to get the drum out, just move it to one side on the other panel, and then the drum will come out. Okay, here's the actual plastic cover, which most probably, I imagine they sell hundreds of these because the amount of people that break them thinking that this comes off this way, not from the rear of the machine. Four screws in here will release the bearing assembly, and then you've got the notorious bolt that you can't get access to. They have put a hole in here, but let me bring this up to the camera and you can see how shallow that is. This is exceedingly shallow Allen key holder, and this is why it's a two-man job. So anyway, we've got the drum out. Now, while I'm at this point, you would now be able to remove this side panel. There are two hidden screws at the bottom here if you need to remove the front panel. These screws are bottom left and bottom right of the machine. Then you would take the facial panel off the machine, and also the two screws for the hinges and one screw for the door interlock assembly. Your pads are here, which are to support the drum, and you've got a felt at the front which can wear as well. Now you've got this off, or the drum out of the machine, of course you would be able to get full access to the Ntc sensor, which I showed you earlier. The actual design of the machine is not bad. It's just the thought that has gone in to actually building this in a way that a person can actually repair it. Manufacturers seem to be building machines either with parts so expensive it's uneconomical to repair, or they decide to build a machine that is so horrible to actually work on that you don't want to repair it. So it's a win-win situation for the manufacturers, but the consumers, zero chance of ever getting ahead. I've just repositioned the camera for you. As you can see, it is possible to get a spanner down that way to hold the actual capacitor to actually remove it. I'm pretty sure you can actually get a spanner down there. Yes, you can. So it does make it a little bit easier, but you still have to take the whole drum out of the machine to change the capacitor. Or you might be able to do it if you've got a very, very small spanner about that big to get in from this side. The Ntc sensor is here, and as I said, there's a couple of clips to actually hold that in place that you just need to prise that out. And there's also another connection down here, and that is a magnetic filter switch. I'm not actually sure what that does. I'd be very interested to hear from anyone that works on these on a regular basis, and my commiserations to you. But basically, I'd be interested to know what that does. If you need to get at the fan filter with the drum out, you will be able to depress all these clips and actually remove the motor to gain access to the fan blade. The type of symptoms that you might have if the fan blade is noisy or warped is you will hear a rubbing sound as the machine is going round. This fan blade actually distributes the air through the drum, pulls it through, and then out through the vent system. And that's basically the whole machine. I'll now reassemble this for you. I'm going to do it in time-lapse mode, I think, because I think it's going to be a frustrating job, and we'll just go from there. Just quickly, I actually put the filter plate, or the cover, on the inside back on to hold the bolt in place. Okay, don't forget to put this spacer back in, and that actually sits with the flush side going like that, and then the heater, little bit in the middle there, will sit inside that. You will need to just maneuver the cabinet slightly to get all this in place. And then you've got to line up the bolt to come through. And that is in place. And I'm going to get the screws on that straight away to hold it all. Then the washer goes on, the spring washer, and the nut. And I will have to get someone to pop in later to actually hold this in place so I can do it up. Because as you see, I'm trying to do it up now, and the shaft is actually turning. So I do need to get the Allen key on the inside to hold it all in place. Next, we're going to put the belt on. Just take the belt so it lines up on the old marking. And I'll line that up properly in a second. Everything is connected correctly. Make sure these tabs go in place. Now connect all the wiring back up. Just double checking that the belt is sitting perfectly located on its old original markings. And this is quite easy to do by just sliding the belt over. Lastly, I'm just going to quickly show you the circuit board connections and also explain the relay. These relays do fail occasionally, so if you have checked the heating circuit, that is your heater relay. And it's a 15 amp relay, HF105F/1. It's slightly different size to a lot of machines that I've seen, but it is possible to desolder that and replace it if you ever have a heating problem where everything else is tested perfectly. You may have a fault with the relay. The circuit board connections here for the motor, for the actual NTC sensors and the thermostatic and heater system, and that's everything on there. So I'll just quickly reassemble that. There's a link in the description below to parts for this machine and also any other useful videos that may assist you in repairing your tumble dryer. I hope you enjoyed the video. Remember to support the website by clicking on the Buy Paul a Beer page, which is also in the description below. And remember to shop with us, as that's what keeps us going and able to make these videos for you. I'm sorry this video was slightly long, but it was awfully complicated the way it was constructed. And I hope this video saves you a bundle of time in accessing some of the components. Thanks very much indeed for watching.